Welcome, fellow students,
ladies and gentlemen, and esteemed adjudicators.
Which of you had a good meal this morning or last night? Which of you get pocket money or go out with your friends? Please raise your hand. Well, you each conceive yourself, all of you do those things. You see, the people that I am about to talk about don't even get a decent meal. They only eat maybe about one a day, and it is not a very big meal. £2 a day will provide food and clean water for many of the communities, which would help people who have been forced from their homes to rebuild their lives. £2 a day will provide an education for thousands of young children who are living in camps. Just imagine sitting in your house, watching TV or reading a book, and a civil war breaks out between the two main leaders of your country. Rockets start to fly over your house, and one of those rockets hits your friends. Well, that is how these children feel. They are drove from their homes in fright of being next. Please, please support Choker's campaign to help these children and adults have a better life. I leave you with this quote from Matthew, verse 25:35-40. I was a stranger and you welcomed me. Whatever you did for the least of my family, you did it for me. Thanks for listening.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, and fellow students and esteemed
displaced people in the world. At present, between 25 and 30 million people have fled from their homes because their lives are in danger. This group of people are called displaced people. They may be in danger for a number of reasons, for example, war or natural disaster. It can happen to people of all ages. However, it is usually elderly people, women and children that are mostly affected. I think it is very sad that people are forced to leave their homes. A lot of people take it for granted that they have a roof over their heads, somewhere to sleep at night, while others are forced from their homes. They often take only what they can carry, and even then these are often stolen or confiscated on their journey to their new settlements. Can we even begin to imagine the great anxiety this lends to Choker's highlighting the plight of displaced people in Colombia, Burma, Kenya, Israel, Sudan, Zimbabwe and Iraq. Any donation that we give to Choker will be greatly appreciated and we will be used to help these people. Instead of using your pocket money this week to buy things for yourself, you could donate the money to charities like Choker, which care for displaced people. We can change the lives of people for the better without even leaving our own homes. Thank you.
I actually enjoyed going to watch the sixth years debate as well.
Yeah.
It's like
you
get involved in it and you really aspire to be like them.
Sounds like I know with the people from Victoria.
Yeah.
And then you really good.
Do we win that result?
Yeah,
one.
That was enough.
That was good.
I enjoyed also the debate about Choker, whether like you give huge contributions or small ones.
Yeah.
That was good when you
got
really into the military bit of it.
Because you really need people like us just want to go to give small contributions to make them feel as if we're making a difference.
I love the way you can write the speeches and then afterwards you can just kind of debate. It comes naturally. It's just really good like that.
You've got all the facts.
Yeah, you can prepare, but you know, you kind of backed yourself up. It's good with Kieran and Sarah though, because they obviously know what they're talking about, especially
Kieran
with the historical point of view as well.
He's not the best drawer though.
No. But
he's very smart. He knows what he's talking about when he talks.
He can back it all up.
Yeah.
If the proposition's true aim is to divert money from private indulgence to public good, and not merely to display their anger at the excesses of modern society, surely they must realise that their proposal is an ineffective method of doing so. It is clearly evident that the proposition possessed an admirable concern for the plight of the underdog in this financial crisis. What is not so admirable, however, is their inability to see the deeper effects that forcing the wealthier members of society to take responsibility would cause. Our opposition's attempt to apportion blame to those who deserve it will ultimately force innocent people to experience further suffering.
The world's finance market spells disaster for many working class citizens. However, I implore our opposition not to be so naive as to overlook, or worse, disregard the domino effect that forcing the rich to pay will have upon less well-off members of society.
Ladies and gentlemen, If your house were on fire, would you fan the flames? I ask this question because if we accept the proposed motion, we will be saying to the outside world that no, we do not wish to approach this issue rationally. We would much rather plunder and pillage and drive our society yet deeper into recession. However, I do not feel that anyone here would fan the flames or stand in the middle of the house and waste their time blaming the person who started the fire. I think that most people would think rationally and decide the best course of action would be to promptly exit and not be so consumed by blame that the fire consumes you soon after. The same reason and logic apply here, only this time we cannot leave the burning house, so we must instead extinguish the flames. The fact is that making the rich pay for this crisis would not resolve the situation, but dramatically intensify it. By financially weakening the rich within our society, the businessmen, the shop owners, the employers, we are dramatically weakening our society as a whole. Do we wish to worsen the unemployment? Do we wish to put more people out in the streets? Because these are the long-term effects of taxing those who drive our economy to the point where they can no longer do so. It simply cannot be done. Even if we were to bow to this rampant and anger-filled motion, we would not be able to implement it because we would further plunge this country into instability. However, if we thought the ignorance of this motion ended here, we would be wrong. While sending this country down in flames, you see, the proposition have also removed the one bucket of water which could put them out. Adam Smith, one of the greatest economists and philosophers of our time, once said, "It is not from the benevolence of the butcher, the baker, or the brewer that we expect our dinner. We address ourselves not to their humanity, but to their self-love." These words by Adam Smith, which highlight in one sentence just what motivates our economy, address the other hugely important reason why this motion is practically destructive. This reason is incentive. If we remove the right of the wealthy to be wealthy, if we remove the incentive, the drive, for people to put the work in and elevate themselves to these positions, we are removing the one thing which could help pull us out of this crisis, economic growth. This motion would not only worsen our economic situation, it would actually remove the few things which could get our economy back on track again, crippling us indefinitely. The final way in which this motion fails, the nail in the coffin, if you will, is in its complete lack of ethical integrity. It shocks me to the core that the proposition could simply advocate such an unethical solution as to take money from those who have earned it. Is it not unjust to effectively steal from someone just because they have something that you want? Some may argue that the plight of many a family at the minute is not just either. However, I put it to these few. Is it just to tell people that making the rich pay for this crisis will alleviate their pain when in fact it will only increase it? Alas, we are not being absolutist. We have no problem with the bankers, who did not do their job effectively, being penalised in the context of their job. What we do have a problem with, however, is a situation whereby we have a large canvas of people, simply dubbed rich, who earned their wealth legally, who are being robbed in the name of fairness. To summarise, we must realise that blame and retribution will not solve this problem. We could all leave right now, march down to the nearest bank and take action, as the proposition would most likely call it. However, even if we stripped the place bare, right down to its office supplies, it would do no good. We would merely be left with a worsening recession and more paperclips than we know what to do with. With concerns to making the rich pay for the bailout, only so as to suffer a sustained recession in the long run, we must realise that any economic plan which can be summed up by the salesman-esque phrase, buy now, pay later, is most likely a bad idea. And finally, when it comes to ethics, my friends, we implore you to remember that two wrongs do not make a right.
From the soaring peaks of the moors to the cavernous depths of Marble Arch, Northern Ireland is a society divided in its differences. This split transcends the years since Northern Ireland's conception and the geography of our beautiful country to the political reality of today's province. Quite simply, the ideology of most of our community means that in order to maintain the peaceful Northern Ireland we have reveled in since 1998, rule from one semi-representative government is impossible. in order to maintain the decommissioning, which has been the saviour of Northern Ireland, Northern Irish society, which is a requirement of devolution, this House begs the audience to realise that, in our conflicted but newly peaceful Northern Ireland, devolution is the only solution.
Direct rule, which is the only other realistic alternative to devolution, succeeded in destroying all faith in political competence in Northern Ireland. Ladies and gentlemen, we must not allow ourselves to become a victim of history. It is our responsibility to reshape and redefine. Devolution failed before because Northern Ireland was shelved policy to Westminster. Devolution is the solution, not only because it is, in its entirety, the only real political viable option, but also because we have learned from our mistakes and from our wrong actions. We are now writing our own history. As a result of devolution, we are achieving so much more than we ever could have envisaged. 20 years ago, if you were to approach a stranger on the street and tell him that the turn of the millennium would bring Ian Paisley visiting the streets of Dublin, or that an Irish president would have been warmly welcomed by hardline loyalists on the Shankill, their likely response would have been, "I'd sooner see pigs fly." 20 years ago, at the height of our atrocities, if you were to tell that same stranger that we would invest hundreds of millions of pounds into the regeneration of the Titanic Quarter and our new Victoria Centre, situated in the heart of Belfast, or that John Lewis would be willing to invest over £150 million in our local economy, I'm sure that at this point he would be complaining about shooting pains up and down his left arm.
You're getting closer and closer to my nose, and I'm not going to move.
Yeah, I'm filming you now. You know I'm filming you.
Are you filming us now?
Yes. Say something and tell us.
What are we
doing? Where did Ian go? Right.
The most natural way to hold the gavel.
No, you look odd. Brilliantly in your speech.
Well, I've had the best support. I've had the best year, so...